Good morning. We begin with shocking news this morning. The bomb maker from the 2002 Bali attacks, Umar Patek, has walked free from prison overnight. He has served only half of his 20-year sentence. Let's bring in reporter Damien Ryan. Damo, survivors are expressing their outrage this morning, understandably.
Why wouldn't they? And of course, they knew this was happening because in October, the governor announced that they were going to release this man, Umar Patek. But because it clashed with the 20th anniversary of the bombing, they delayed it, put it on hold. And then, of course, they had the world's leaders there at G20. It was not a good look. So they waited, and they waited until yesterday. In the early hours of yesterday morning, he walked free from an East Java jail where he spent the last close to 10 years. He'd been a poster boy in this jail. We'd seen images of him being paraded through the jail as a poster boy for de-radicalisation. His release was nothing like that. There was little fanfare. They snuck him out of jail in the early hours of the morning and then released and made a public restatement about 10 hours later that he's no longer in jail. He's now a free man. And, of course, the news spread overnight here in Australia. We know what he did. He made the bombs, which killed 202 people, 88 Australians. And you just wonder how they're feeling today. One of those is Jan Jelizinski. He spoke on the Today Show this morning and he was rightfully disgusted.
Very distraught, shocked really. I still can't understand how this person that created so much loss of life, not just for 88 Australians, 202 people could be walking free this morning here in over in Indonesia. It just doesn't sit well at all. I can't understand it.
We know both governments, previous governments and this government, have tried to arm twist the Indonesians to say, look, don't let this happen. The Prime Minister, just a couple of months ago said it was abhorrent to think that he was going to be released from jail. Well, we haven't heard from the Prime Minister today because, of course, he's locked away with COVID, but it'll be interesting to see what he says on this, his spin. But, for many, many Australians today, this is just another sad day for them because it all comes flooding back. It's worth noting that, look, he is a free man. He's left the jail with his wife and they will now live close by in Surabaya. He's insisted he would one day like to go back to Bali, which is even more frightening. He will remain on parole until 2030. So they'll allegedly keep tabs on him. And if he does anything wrong, he'll go back to jail for another 10 years.
Yeah, you do question whether someone who has done that can actually be de-radicalised.
Well, just look at him. He's having a bit of fun there, you know. So he's out and... But he's left a lot of misery behind.
A lot of people in Australia rightly outraged this morning. Damo, thank you for your insights. Well, there are heavy delays on the Hume motorway southwest of Sydney this morning after a car and semi-trailer collided just past Picton Road. Traffic has been banked up for 5 kilometres southbound at Pheasant's Nest near the Twin Servos. One lane is blocked and emergency services are on scene. Crews are facing a huge clean-up with 500 litres of diesel spilled across that road. A Sydney man will face court over the alleged supply of illegal drugs after police discovered a stash worth $600,000 in two CBD hotel rooms. 52-year-old Ashley Hall was arrested yesterday and charged with 23 offences. He's been refused bail. An investigation is underway after a group of cleaners found human remains buried beneath a unit block on Brisbane's north side. Meg Sides reports.
The crime scene remains in place here this morning. Police combing through evidence, working to figure out how a body came to be buried in a void underneath this unit complex. The grisly discovery was made yesterday by cleaners contracted to remove property from the storage space. Police say the body was wrapped in at least 5 layers of plastic and had been there for several months, hidden beneath clothing and bedding. Today, they're interviewing residents as they search for answers. We spoke to one a short time ago.
To have all these police everywhere, it's pretty bloody... It's a bit different.
Police are currently sifting through hundreds of missing persons files as they work to identify the body and ultimately the killers.
As we go to air, energy ministers are meeting to try to hash out a solution to the country's ongoing power price crisis. Federal politics reporter Ashley Wick joins us now from Canberra. Ash, good morning. What are we expecting to come out of this meeting?
Good morning, Sophie. Well, skyrocketing energy prices will be high on the agenda this morning. State and federal ministers are right now sitting down in Brisbane discussing longer-term solutions to the power price pain. So things like transitioning to renewables and a new capacity mechanism to support more electricity going into the grid. These things will take time to flow through to household power bills, however. So in the background today, the Prime Minister and states are negotiating to try and reach a short-term solution and intervene in the energy market. The Federal Energy Minister, Chris Bowen, acknowledging there is a lot of work to do.
We have certain powers at the federal level which are strong and we'll use them. The states have other powers which might be more effective in some instances. So let's talk to the states about them using their powers, us using ours, working together.
Now, one option is capping the price of coal and gas, two crucial but expensive resources. The federal government is asking the states to consider this and offering compensation for broken contracts and lost revenue. However, the current figure that is on the table may not be enough to win over everyone. Now, National Cabinet meets tomorrow and it is hoped that the leaders can reach an agreement then. The clock is ticking on this, Sophie, because a plan doesn't mean instant relief. It could be months before any intervention flows through to household bills.
Which isn't good, Ash, thank you. Still reeling from the country's biggest cyber attack, Medibank will overhaul its security system this weekend, closing its customer contact centre and all retail stores. Customers won't be able to access Medibank and AHM services or file on-the-spot claims from Friday night. It comes after the health insurer refused to pay a $15 million ransom to recover stolen records. Wild winds have wreaked havoc across Melbourne overnight, with the SES inundated with calls for help. Strong gusts brought down a large tree and power lines at Burwood East around 10:30. The fallen trunk crushing two parked cars and causing minor damage to a house. Several homes in the area lost power. No injuries have been reported. Commuters in Brisbane's west were delayed this morning when a sinkhole shut down a major arterial into the city following heavy rain overnight. Peter Fegan joins us live. Peter, how long is it expected to take to fix?
G'day, Soph. Well, the way these crews are moving this morning, it shouldn't take much longer at all. I'll get Gibbsy to zoom in here. I'll give you a better idea of what they're doing. They've got the vacuum excavation team in here at the moment, sucking up all the sludge and the water that's created inside this hole. We've had the backhoe here for quite some time, digging up all that loose gravel, loading it out into trucks. And I'll just and what they'll do then is they'll fill it back in, and of course they'll seal it. So it shouldn't take too much longer. They hope to have it open for the run home. Sophie, I'll just put into context for people that don't know Brisbane well. I'm standing on Coronation Drive, as you mentioned off the top, a major arterial that connects the western suburbs of Brisbane to the city. So you can only imagine the stress it caused commuters this morning. But I must say they handled it quite well. The section of road that is closed is from the Regatta Hotel to the Wesley Hospital. It's a small section of road, but police opened up Land Street and turned the traffic lights off. It was slower than usual, but Sophie, it could have been a lot worse. Now, police were first alerted to this sinkhole in the early hours of this morning, before the sun was up and just after that heavy rain that we experienced had eased. So it was their quick actions that actually stopped any drivers from driving into it. So it was quite lucky they put controls in place quite quickly. Now, just lastly, for drivers or commuters that may be wanting to head into the city, the inbound lanes here are still closed throughout that section I mentioned. The advice is, of course, to use Milton Road and stay away from it for now. But again, Sophie, hopefully they'll have this open for the run home.
That is good to hear, Peter. Thank you. Well, there are fears this morning thousands of Victorians are living with undiagnosed cancer as a result of the COVID pandemic. Isabella Staszkowski has the details.
According to a new study, almost 4,000 Victorians living with cancer unknowingly that would have been discovered in 2020 and 2021 if it wasn't for the pandemic. The Victorian Cancer Registry has published its latest report showing a nasty hangover from COVID, raising concerns that people are slipping through the cracks and will continue to. A breakdown of the diagnosis shortfall estimates, among other cancers, almost 850 bowel cancers have gone undiagnosed, while more than 250 lung cancers have not been discovered. The report warns this trend could continue for a number of years in Victoria, with cancer diagnosis to increase some 43% over the next 15 years. The one positive finding was that for the first time, the five-year cancer survival rate in Victoria was surpassed by 70% of patients. Experts do hope that shining a light on these statistics will encourage Victorians to get a checkup, explaining that early detection can be life-saving.